COVID-19, SARS-CoV-2, the coronavirus, no matter which name, you've heard of the virus and the pandemic it's caused, impacting lives physically, financially, and socially. Billions of people are social distancing, and while we do our part to combat the spread of the disease, researchers are working endlessly to produce a sustainable and reliable vaccine to finally end this crisis. As we've seen in the news, there are teams globally working on vaccine solutions. And as of April 8th, there are 115 vaccine candidates in varying stages of research. Every day, there seems to be a new development. Private companies like Moderna and Inovio are making headlines as they're quickly progressing in the first stages of the vaccine approval process. A process that usually takes years is being pushed in a matter of months. And that's the question. With urgency looming, how viable are many of these fast vaccines? And are we going to have a vaccine solution within a year? Short answer, a very apprehensive maybe.
So if everything by everybody in every place worked perfectly, could you theoretically accomplish this in 18 months?
I think it's optimistically 12 to 18 months. Under normal circumstances, it takes 5 to 10 years to develop a vaccine.
It is a process designed to be appropriately slow, reflective, evidence-based, peer-reviewed by other scientists, and then used.
And under normal circumstances, taking vaccines from the lab to licensing for public distribution not only takes time, but money. Roughly $1 billion worth or more. But a large part of the acceleration of the vaccines we're hearing about have to do with an international organization that launched in 2017 called the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, or CEPI.
The thing about these vaccines is that you need to have funding to move from one stage to the next.
Zika disappeared, so they took the money away. Ebola disappeared, so no money. You have to get out of that cycle.
And so actually CEPI emerged because they knew that this was a problem. What would we do if something big came up? And of course, it's a good thing they planned because something big did come up. And that's why CEPI had the funding available immediately to give to organizations like Moderna, CureVac, Inovio, and Queensland.
And while the funding helps to speed up the process, the teams chosen by CEPI also are already ahead in their vaccine research. Teams either have experience with previous outbreaks like MERS, or working on novel vaccine methods that could significantly reduce the development timeline. But before we get carried away with how these new research platforms work, we should know the vaccine basics. Essentially, a vaccine can be made in a few different ways. We have inactivated and live attenuated, both known as whole pathogen vaccines, subunit vaccines, including recombinant, polysaccharide, and conjugate vaccines, which are using a piece of the pathogen, or the newer method of nucleic acid vaccines, using the DNA or RNA of the pathogen. When injected into our bodies, vaccines all aim to mimic the infectious agent. Typically, a vaccine is often given with an adjuvant to boost the initial immune response. After the injection, this response sounds the alarm in our body and begins the organization of white blood cells, like killer T cells, and specific proteins called antibodies. Killer T cells destroy the pathogen in the infected cells, and the antibodies neutralize the pathogen. In SARS-CoV-2's case, the antibodies head toward the recognizable spike proteins on the outer shell of the coronavirus and block the proteins from connecting to the receptors of our cells. This whole process helps the body's immune system get trained by the vaccine and retain the memory of the infection, so that when a vaccinated person encounters a real virus, like SARS-CoV-2, they can quickly recover. So basically, your body comes up with the preventative measures it needs to fight the pathogen. We just need to initiate that exposure.
In the old days, we would just grind up the virus or the bacteria and kill it with formalin or heat and inject it into animals. And sometimes that works, sometimes it doesn't. As we've gotten more sophisticated, now we can use molecular biology to either make these tiny little proteins or to make particles that look like the virus, or you can make DNA or RNA vaccines. All of these things have a potential to work.
So which ones are CEPI focusing on? Well, right now they have a number of funded vaccine candidates in their portfolio. But out of those funded platforms, we're hearing mostly about four of them. Two mRNA vaccines from Moderna and CureVac, one DNA vaccine from Inovio, and a protein vaccine from Australia's University of Queensland.
There are no licensed DNA or RNA vaccines. And on the other hand, we believe that they can be made rapidly. I mean, I think you heard Inovio say that within 3 hours of seeing the sequence, they had designed the vaccine that they intended to take into humans. It takes longer for a protein vaccine. It takes longer for a whole inactivated virus vaccine. And every group is pursuing what it does best.
Given the urgency of finding a vaccine during this pandemic, we're looking for new approaches like DNA and RNA vaccines because they can be developed quickly. However, that doesn't mean that work on other promising solutions stops, as experts are advocating for a multi-prong approach when it comes to developing vaccines. Because we'll need as many candidates as we can to pass the rigorous approval phases. But what exactly are these phases? Well, for example, once a viable coronavirus vaccine candidate has been identified in preclinical studies, they can move on to the highly anticipated phase one of the approval process.
Phase one studies involve tens of people. The Moderna mRNA vaccine that's being tested in the US will enroll 45 people. And what you're doing there is you're again looking to see, does it produce an immune response? And does it appear to be safe? Now, you only have tens of people, so you won't see very much.
Once that hurdle is passed, we can enter phase two, where the study enrolls hundreds of patients.
Now you're getting more refined in what dose, how to administer it, how many doses. You're looking again for immunogenicity. You might get some hints about effectiveness, and you're looking for safety.
And so phase two can actually be a fairly long time because you're testing multiple things, you're looking at your results, because really the cost of failure for large companies is huge.
That distance between phase two and phase three is somewhat affectionately called the valley of death. And the reason for it is the vast majority of vaccines and drugs will not make it into or past phase three.
But let's say a coronavirus vaccine does pass. If so, it will go into phase three, where thousands to tens of thousands of people are enrolled in a trial.
Now what you're looking at is efficacy. Does it actually work? Not just raise an immune response, but does it actually prevent disease?
From here, the FDA scrutinizes the data collected across all three phases. If it all looks good, then they give the final approval on licensing and manufacturing. Phew, we did it. It only took hundreds of hours of vaccine development, three major clinical trials, and hundreds of thousands of people, plus a number of approval committees. So by now, you're probably wondering,
how do we telescope something that is 5 to 10 years into something that may be 12 to 18 months? So you do phase two, very close to phase one, maybe overlapping it partially. And then you see that you get the right protective responses in the laboratory. And rather than waiting until you've got all the data to the very end of the trial, you may wait a month to make sure that the best responses are present. And then based on those best responses, either the company or maybe CEPI or a government will say, okay, fine, let's move on to see if this actually protects very quickly. Again, if everything goes right and we see no safety signals, it would be possible. It may be longer. And so we're going to have to get ready for COVID-19 and living with it and figuring out how to work around it.
Okay, so best case scenario, we're looking at 12 to 18 months before we have a viable vaccine. But even if this ambitious timeline is accomplished, researchers will need to find the means of manufacturing it for the some 8 billion people on our planet. But if they overcome all these challenges, we'd be looking at a vaccine that was developed at a historical speed. One with the potential to save millions of lives. COVID-19 is a huge subject, one that's impacted each and every one of us. If there's another aspect of it that you want to see us cover, please let us know in the comments below. And make sure to subscribe to Seeker to see how we follow this news. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.